Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Bonfire, Backpacks, and Brawls by Tonya Kappes, narrated by Johanna Parker. Chapter 1. As the first rays of the sun kissed the serene waters of Happy Trails Campground, I found myself in a rather unusual classroom. An old, weathered aluminum boat that had seen better days, bobbing gently on the lake under the watchful eyes of the vintage campers lining the shore. My instructor? None other than Dottie Swaggart. Dottie wasn't only one of my best friends, she was also the manager of Happy Trails Campground. She'd taken it upon herself to enter us into a bass fishing tournament and teach me the fine art of bass fishing. Why, you ask? Because the Daniel Boone National Forest bass fishing tournament was just around the corner, and we were determined not only to participate, but to win. Well, she was anyways. Me? I was just hoping to be able to do something with her that she enjoyed, since she was always doing things with me that I enjoyed. The campground was buzzing with excitement. Swan paddle boats glided gracefully across the lake, carrying guests in high spirits, while ducks meandered through the water, unperturbed by the human activity. On the sandy beach, campers lounged under the sun, some cheering on the kids to venture into the water, others simply enjoying the peaceful morning. Over by the tiki hut, Henry Bryant, our handyman, had outdone himself decorating with festive lights shaped like fish, setting the perfect backdrop for the upcoming tournament hosted by the local Boy Scouts. The atmosphere was electric, a delightful blend of competition and camaraderie. Dottie, I always thought bass fishing was a matter of skill and the right lure, not this, I said, grimacing as I held up a wriggling worm, its slimy body twisting between my fingers. It was a far cry from the sleek, artificial lures I'd seen in sporting goods stores. Besides, we don't have bass in this lake.
Maybelline,
Dottie chided, with a tone that somehow always managed to be both scolding and endearing. She pronounced my full name in a way that could coax a smile out of me, even when I was knee-deep in mud, or, as it happened, elbow-deep in a bowl of worms. With her cigarette precariously dangling from her lips, she reached over, undeterred by the swinging hook, and demonstrated how to bait the hook with a confidence that left me in awe. The moment the line hit the water, it was as if the lake itself was in on Dottie's lesson, rewarding her with a bite almost immediately.
Whee doggy!
She exclaimed, reeling in a catfish that seemed too big and ugly to belong in our serene setting. As it flopped helplessly in the bottom of the boat, Dottie turned to me, expecting me to take the next step. Removing the fish from the hook was a task I was not prepared for. The sight of the catfish, gasping and flailing, was enough to make me take a step back and think about this whole tournament.
You want me to do what? Put my fingers where?
I couldn't mask my horror. Fishing, it seemed, was not for the faint of heart. Dottie stood up in the rickety aluminum boat, and the sudden shift in weight made it teeter dangerously. My heart leaped to my throat, visions of us tumbling into the lake flashing before my eyes as I steadied myself using a hand to grip each side of the boat. But not Dottie. She was cool as a cucumber, unfazed. She balanced herself with the ease of a seasoned sailor, her focus unbroken. She held the still-flopping catfish firmly in one hand, the other wielding the fishing rod like a maestro conducting an orchestra.
"Pay attention, Maybelline,"
Dottie instructed, her voice steady over the gentle lapping of water against our boat. She jutted the stinky thing in front of my face. I leaned back.
"First things first, you gotta hold the fish right. Grip it just behind the gills, firm, but don't squeeze too hard. You don't want to hurt it more than we already have."
I watched, equal parts fascinated and horrified, as Dottie demonstrated. She cradled the catfish with a tenderness that contrasted with her rugged exterior, her fingers expertly positioned to avoid the spines.
"Next up, dealing with the hook," she continued.
The fish's mouth was slightly agape, revealing the hook lodged firmly inside.
"You see here? The hook's gotta come out the way it went in. No yanking or pulling. That'll just hurt the fish and make a bigger mess."
With the cigarette still perched at the corner of her mouth, Dottie used her free hand to gently press down on the hook's shank, the part attached to the line. This maneuver, she explained, was to disengage the barb from the fish's flesh.
"Then you twist it lightly, just like this,"
she demonstrated the motion,
"and ease the hook out."
The process was delicate, requiring a finesse that I hadn't associated with fishing. Under Dottie's skilled hands, the hook came free with minimal fuss. The catfish, though undoubtedly relieved, continued its frantic dance in Dottie's grasp.
"Now for the release,"
she said, moving toward the side of the boat, which prompted another heart-stopping wobble.
"Always gently, back into the water. We're sportsmen, Maybelline. We respect our opponents, even if they're scaly and spend their lives in the muck."
With a soft splash, the catfish was returned to its aquatic home, disappearing beneath the surface with a flick of its tail, leaving ripples as the only sign of its brief encounter with us. Dottie turned to me, a look of expectation in her eyes.
"Your turn next. And don't worry,"
she added with a wink.
"I've got a feeling you'll be a natural."
"I don't think this is for me," I said, rethinking the whole idea of me begging her for us to do something together that she loved.
"Hogwash,"
she said, pointing directly at me with the fingers now holding the cigarette.
"You asked me what I wanted to do this spring, and you said it should be something I loved. Harrison and I loved fishing, and there ain't no better time for me to teach you something I love than participating in the bass tournament."
There was no way she was going to let me off the hook like she did the catfish.
"Besides, Harrison was a Boy Scout, and he was a leader until he died."
Dottie had never really opened up about her life with him. I'd learned more about him, as well as Dottie, from Nikki Swaggart, Dottie's stepdaughter.
"I know you really love this, but what if I cheer you on from the sideline? I wasn't sure how I was going to get out of this situation. I don't feel like I'm going to get enough practice before tomorrow."
I didn't say it directly, but that was a little dig because I'd been asking her to help me, but she didn't have time to teach me until today, and the tournament was starting tomorrow.
"Look at Henry," I pointed out the handyman, who had somewhat of a hankering for Dottie.
Yes, as in an eye for her. Henry was busy adjusting the fish-shaped lights around the tiki hut, his focus occasionally drifting our way. It was no secret around Normal, our small town nestled in a holler of the Daniel Boone National Forest, that Henry had a soft spot for Dottie. His attempts to catch her attention, usually with a mix of handyman prowess and awkward charm, were as endearing as they were transparent. At one point, they'd been competing in dance competitions, and though Dottie never told me what happened, they stopped. I'm sure it was to do with her getting too close to him. Dottie was so tough on the exterior, but on the inside, she was like a big old bowl of homemade nanner pudding.
"Giving up before we even start ain't the Mae West I know,"
she countered, her voice laced with conviction.
"Harrison believed in trying new things, in pushing out of comfort zones. That's what scouting taught him, and that's what he would have wanted for us,"
Dottie continued, her words carrying the weight of unspoken stories and shared years with her husband. The campground, bustling with activity and the spirit of adventure, seemed to echo her sentiments. The scene around us was vibrant with the life of the campground. Campers of all ages were gearing up for the tournament, their enthusiasm infectious. Children practiced casting lines under the watchful eyes of adults, laughter and chatter filling the air. The scent of barbecue drifted from one of the nearby sites, a reminder of the communal dinner planned for the evening.
"Imagine the stories we'll tell tonight around the campfire,"
Dottie said, gesturing toward the fire pit where campers would later gather, sharing tales and roasting marshmallows under a blanket of stars.
"About how Mae West conquered her first catch, with the whole campground cheering her on."
Her words painted a picture, one where the challenge of the tournament faded into the background, replaced by the warmth of community and the joy of shared experiences. It was a vision hard to resist, one that spoke to the heart of what made Happy Trails special.
"All right, Dottie," I sighed. "Fine, I'll keep trying."
With a deep breath, I steeled myself for the task at hand, reaching back into the styrofoam bowl that housed our squirming bait. My fingers closed around another worm, its body cool and slippery. In my determination to prove myself, my grip was too loose, and the worm made a daring escape, dropping onto the boat's floor with a soft thud.
"Shoot!"
I exclaimed, momentarily forgetting the precarious balance required in our small aluminum vessel. I stood up quickly, intent on rescuing the wayward worm before it could wiggle its way into some unreachable nook. The boat, however, had other plans. My sudden movement to the right sent it tilting dangerously, a silent warning I failed to heed in my worm rescue mission.
The realization hit me a fraction of a second too late. My eyes widened in shock, and a string of sputtering words escaped me as the world seemed to tilt on its axis. "Dottie!" was all I managed before the boat gave a final, traitorous lurch, sending us both tumbling into the cool embrace of the lake. The water closed over my head, a shock of cold that drove the breath from my lungs. I surfaced, sputtering and coughing, the taste of fresh water mingling with a bizarre sense of exhilaration. Above the sound of my own splashing, I could hear Dottie's laughter, a rich, infectious sound that seemed to bubble up from the very depths of the lake. I blinked the water from my eyes, just in time to see her grinning at me, her hair plastered to her head, making her look both ridiculous and endearing.
"Well, Mae, that's one way to get acquainted with the fish," she joked, still chuckling as she treaded water beside me.
Around us, the boat floated serenely, as if mocking our unplanned dive. Just as I managed to catch my breath from the laughter and the shock of the cold water, a small splash announced the arrival of Fifi, my little white poodle. With a grace that only a dog of her stature as a retired pedigreed show dog could manage, she paddled through the water toward us, her determination as clear as the water around her. It was a sight that only added to the hilarity of our situation, her tiny legs moving in a perfect doggy paddle as she made her way to her floundering humans. On the beach, Chester, Hank and my loyal hunting dog, was making his own contribution to the commotion. Unable to contain his worry and excitement, he paced back and forth along the water's edge, howling mournfully. It was as if he was chastising us for a reckless plunge, or perhaps lamenting his inability to join the rescue efforts due to an understandable hesitation about the water. Dottie and I exchanged amused glances, our bond strengthened by the shared ordeal, and now by the antics of my dogs. "Looks like the cavalry has arrived," I quipped, nodding toward Fifi, who was now circling us with an eagerness that belied her small size, before she caught sight of the ducks close by and started her swim toward them.
"And Chester's leading the charge from the shore,"
Dottie added, laughter still lacing her voice. She reached out to scoop Fifi from the water, holding her up so that the little poodle could shake off, sending droplets flying in all directions. The sound of a small boat engine cut through the laughter and chatter from the shore. We turned to see Henry maneuvering a small motorboat toward us with a determined look on his face. It was as if he had sensed our predicament from afar, or perhaps Chester's howling had been more effective than any distress signal. "Looks like our knight in shining armor has traded his horse for horsepower," I remarked, unable to resist the pun. The sight of Henry, always ready to leap into action, brought a sense of relief mingled with amusement. There he was with his unwavering readiness to assist, whether it was fixing a broken step, stringing up fish-shaped lights, or now, rescuing two wayward fisherwomen from their unintended swim. As Henry's boat drew near, the engine's hum grew louder.
"Need a lift?"
Henry called out, a grin spreading across his face as he cut the engine, allowing the boat to drift the final few feet toward us. His eyes twinkled with a mix of concern and mirth, clearly amused by the sight before him, but ready to lend a hand.
"You owe me some cigarettes."
Dottie held up her waterlogged pleather cigarette case once we were settled in Henry's boat, the warmth of the sun drying our damp clothes. Dottie leaned toward Henry with a conspiratorial gleam in her eye.
"You know, Henry, I reckon Mae just ain't cut out for this fishing business,"
she said, her voice rich with the melodious twang of the South.
"She's more suited to dry land adventures, if you catch my drift."
She paused for a moment, allowing a playful smile to dance across her lips before continuing.
"So, how about it? Would you like to take her place in the tournament? Lord knows, we might stand a chance of catching more than a cold with you on the team."
Henry, ever the gentleman, chuckled at Dottie's suggestion, the idea clearly appealing to him. His eyes met mine in the rearview mirror of the boat, a silent question hanging in the air.
"You can have the day off if you get me off the hook, literally,"
I said with a smile. It was a proposition that made sense. Henry, with his keen eye and steady hand, was undoubtedly more adept at the nuances of fishing than I could ever hope to be on such short notice.
"I suppose,"
was Henry's answer. As the boat glided back to shore, the laughter and lighthearted banter between us underscored the unbreakable bonds that tied the three of us together. And the little hint of romance between Dottie and Henry that I thought had been lost, it was more alive than ever.
Chapter 2 Happy Trails Campground had become my home over the past few years, and when I got married last fall to Hank Sharp, I knew even then there was no way I was ever going to move back into a brick-and-mortar-style home. I'd given up my cute little orange drivable camper to live in Hank's big fifth wheel that was really entirely too big for the two of us, Fifi and Chester. It was probably the fact that it was just a lot to clean. Thankfully, neither dog shed, so that was at least a plus. I did make a few marketing posts using hashtags like Bass Fishing Tournament, Daniel Boone National Forest, Fishin', and Mill Creek Lake, Abby Fawn Bonds, our local librarian, and my sister-in-law said. I trust you, I told her, the phone nestled between my ear and shoulder. You're the marketing whiz. And that she was. Without her, there wouldn't be a thriving Happy Trails campground with a wait list as long as your arm. She took me in the first day I rolled into Normal, and even though I was here under some dire circumstances, she didn't give my situation one thought. She simply told me she could help me fill up some camping lots. And before you knew it, Happy Trails Campground not only was up and running, it was thriving. Bobby Ray and I'll be over in about an hour. He had some boats come in late this afternoon that needed to be looked at, she said, referring to my foster brother, who I only considered as my brother now. And that's how I referred to him, Bobby Ray Bonds, my brother. He worked at the only gas station that offered mechanic work, he being the best mechanic in the world, and I mean the world. He had moved to Normal after me and had gotten a job at Grassel Gas Station, working with Joel Grassel. Joel was a local. Like Hank, he grew up here and never left. Speaking of boats, how are the lessons coming along? Abby asked. I've been replaced with Henry Bryant. I walked up the few steps on the far side of the fifth wheel to dust the end tables next to the leather couches and glanced out the window. I couldn't contain the smile I got from watching my campground guests with their phones, pointing fingers, and fancy cameras, as they too saw how spectacular the sun was as it started its descent over the mountainous backdrop of the forest. Majestic. That's a big word, and it held a lot of meaning, but it truly was how I would describe how the sunset looked tonight. The forest silhouette against the fiery sky created a stunning contrast, with hues of orange, pink, and deep purple melding together in a painterly display that seemed almost too beautiful to be real. The towering trees, which during the day stood as proud sentinels of the wilderness, now appeared as dark figures watching over the campground, their outlines softened by the fading light. The serene waters of the lake, nestled within the vast expanse of natural beauty, reflected the sky's vibrant colors, doubling the visual effects of the setting sun. The lake's surface, usually bustling with activity during the day, was now a mirror to the sky's performance, disturbed only by the occasional fish jumping, creating ripples that spread like whispers across the water. Even the ducks had gotten out, as if they too were witnessing something majestic. Oh no, Abby gasped, then she snickered, abruptly stopping. Hey, that's the library on the other line. I'll see you soon. She popped off without saying goodbye, and that was okay. Abby was a busy woman, and I was just here finishing my cleaning, waiting for Hank to get off work. I stood there a moment longer, watching the campground transform before my eyes as the sun dipped behind the trees. The vintage campers and modern RVs alike seemed to settle in for the evening, their windows glowing with warm light, casting cozy shadows against the ground. The aroma of campfires began to mingle with the crisp evening air, a signal that the night's storytelling and marshmallow roasting were about to commence. Laughter and soft music floated from different corners of the campground, creating a soundtrack to the evening's tranquility. The click of Fifi's toenails brought me back to the moment inside the camper where she and Chester were dancing around empty food bowls in the kitchen. All right, let's eat. I said, and took the steps back down to the large eat-in kitchen with a too-fancy-for-me island in the middle. Before I could get the dogs' bowls filled with their kibble and freshen up their water, the familiar rumble of Hank's big truck came from outside. Daddy's home, I said, but the dogs were too busy trying to scarf down their food to even care. Even though I shouldn't care, and I knew Hank didn't, I rushed over to the small bathroom off the kitchen and gave myself a once-over in the mirror before I got to the door to greet him. Whoa! Hank's green eyes lit up, and his smile sent my heart a flutter. I wasn't expecting this greeting. The best thing happened today! I threw my arms around him and gave him one big old kiss on his lips. Gosh! He blushed.
I want good things to happen every day if I get this kind of welcome home.
While you get out of your ranger uniform, I'll tell you all about it. I hurried him past the kitchen and up the opposite side of the camper to the steps leading up to our bedroom.
Okay, he said with a worried tone. Is it going to cost me?
He asked, leery of what was making me so happy. Actually, it's losing us a few $1,000, I said, shaking my head as I sat down on the bed while he headed into our bathroom to clean up from his day out in the woods for his pretty new ranger's position as the now low man on the job. Like I'd said, Hank grew up here. He knew the forest better than anyone. I'd even put money on it. Speaking of money, you know the bass tournament has that big $5,000 prize money and all the other tiers to win? I called out, sitting down cross-legged so Fifi, now finished eating, could get in my lap.
Well, we have no chance of winning it.
Huh?
Hank popped his head out of the door of the bathroom, his toothbrush in his mouth.
Turns out I'm not so good at fishing. And when I stood up, the boat went.
I whistled like a torpedo and used my fingers to gesture an explosion.
You tipped the boat over?
Hank asked before he belted out a huge belly laugh.
I bet Dottie was fit to be tied.
Oh, Hank. I tried not to mirror his smirk, but it was too funny.
Her hair was flat to her head when she got out of the water, and Henry had to come save us.
I was hyperventilating as I told him about Fifi jumping in after us, but leaving us when the ducks came along.
But the best part was how I realized Dottie was so embarrassed when Henry saw her. She didn't think I noticed, but I did.
Now, May, don't be going around playing matchmaker again,
he warned, as if I was going to listen to him. I don't have to, I shrugged, picking Fifi up and sliding us off the bed to go to the bathroom and watch Hank finish getting all fixed up for the big camping to-do we were hosting tonight.
Fate is going to play its own hand. Besides, both of them are stubborn, and they deserve to be happy.
Mm-hmm.
Hank looked in the mirror, staring at me.
Even Fifi looks like she had a hand in your little tip over.
Are you saying I did it on purpose?
I asked.
I wouldn't put it past you.
His brow rose, and his hand slid through his hair with a little bit of gel to slick it to the side.
I've seen you operate, May.
I got you, didn't I?
I winked and turned around on the balls of my feet, giving a little more sway to my walk.
I see you,
Hank called out in a teasing tone.
Come on, you've got stew to get on the campfire.
I called to him from the kitchen, putting Fifi on the ground, only to replace her with a big cast iron kettle I'd taken out of the refrigerator for our contribution to tonight's feast. Every month since I took over the campground, I hosted a monthly supper for not only the guests at Happy Trails, but the townsfolk as well. Everyone in the campground was encouraged to make something on their campfire to eat, and it was like a progressive dinner, but in a campground. Everyone could walk around and get a sampling of what everyone else was cooking, and they got to know each other that way. If shop owners from town came, they were more than welcome to set up a little area underneath the awning of the recreational building up near the office. Campers could come and check out what the shop owners had to offer, so they would be tempted to take a day to go into town during their stay and check out the shops. It was a win-win for everyone. How was your day? I asked, grabbing Fifi's leash. She wasn't allowed to go outside after dark due to the fact there were bigger critters out in the woods that would love to have her for a snack.
It's always a task getting all the things ready, not only for the adults, but the kids' fishing derby is a challenge.
Hank was so good with the kids.
We're making sure the adults who are entering have their licenses and the right lures and that they know the weight limits.
Instead of shutting the door on the camper, I shut the screen since we were going to be hanging around the campground. The night air was fresh, and I loved the smell of freshly cooked food over the campfire that would linger in the camper long after we went to bed.
The kids will be easy. Maybe they will give me kid duty the day of the tournament,
he said, and handed me Fifi's leash once I finished shutting the screen door. As we walked down the campground, I recalled the first and only time Hank took me fishing. I remembered how he made sure I had all of these things, and I was bored out of my mind. He mentioned all the weight restrictions that determined whether a fish was a keeper or had to be thrown back, but I wasn't listening to him. All I could remember thinking was how much longer I had to stay out on that boat. Give me a yacht all day long, but a small fishing boat where I had to try and get my own food? Forget it.
Are you happy?
I asked, jerking a little when Fifi extended the leash to its fullest.
Of course I'm happy,
Hank curled his arm around me as we rounded the far end of the lake where the bungalows we rented were located.
I'm here, with you and them.
He pointed to the dogs. Chester was so good about staying next to Hank that he didn't require a leash. Plus, he was a hunting dog, which made it easier for us if he smelled something that we needed to be leery of. I mean, with your job. I wanted Hank to be happy. He'd been a ranger before he took the job with his old police pal, Jerry Truman, in their private investigation business. But not too many PIs were needed in a town the size of Normal.
Honestly?
The way he said it, I felt like I was going to be in for some sort of shocking answer. Like he wasn't happy, but the truth was far from it.
I didn't realize just how much I'd missed it until I was out there in the woods on a call, helping someone who had gotten lost and was using their GPS to track them.
It was nice to see the smile on his face as he told me all about finding the kid who had strayed from his sister while they were hiking and the parents were back at their campsite.
I think I'm good, but you know,
he snickered.
I thought I would hate being low man on the stick again, but I really feel alive when I'm out there.
And it's fishing season, I said, knowing just how much he loved getting out on the water and taking some much-needed downtime for the sport.
That too, he said. I don't mind getting out there and just driving around to check licenses, make sure everyone is throwing back if the fish size is wrong.
As crazy as it sounded, there was a catch-and-release law that was adhered to by the size of the fish, and it was something the rangers and Kentucky Wildlife and Game took very serious. It was actually an illegal offense, and the fisherman was ticketed, or worse, thrown in jail if caught. Hank and I wrapped up our conversation about his renewed passion for his ranger duties, and we made our way to the communal campfire, the heart of the campground's evening activities. The warm glow of the fire made it even cozier, and the familiar faces of the laundry club ladies, my best friends, were gathered, each settled into an Adirondack chair that seemed to embrace them in comfort against the chill of the evening air. Hank and I walked up as Dottie, ever the life of the party, was animatedly recounting a story from one of the campground's more memorable escapades, her laughter infectious as the flames danced in her eyes. Betts Hager, with her wavy, shoulder-length brown hair framing her face, smiled and nodded, her bangs swaying gently in the night breeze. Abby, always the picture of practicality, had her long brown hair pulled back in a ponytail, a look of contentment on her face as she listened to the tales being spun around the fire. Bobby Ray, who had his hand resting on Abby's leg, lounged in his chair, his loose blonde curls catching the firelight. He had a way of making everyone feel at ease, his gentle nature a stark contrast to his rugged appearance. Queenie French was in perpetual motion, with short blonde hair pushed back by her headband. She was the only one who couldn't seem to find stillness, even in the relaxed setting. Her energy was high, a fanny pack snug around her waist, no doubt filled with all manner of things she might need at a moment's notice. I took a seat on one of the open logs we used for sitting right in front of the campfire. The crackling logs and flickering flames served as a perfect backdrop to a night filled with laughter, stories, and the kind of honest conversations that only happen under the open sky. Sitting around like this was one of my most favorite things to do. Looking around, my heart was full, seeing that everyone who I loved, but who didn't live in the campground, was here to support me and Hank. I only hoped I was that for them.
I'm gonna go back to get me another helping of that fish stew from Camping Lot 25,
Dottie said, getting up from her chair.
Anyone else want some? I'll go with you,
Henry Bryant offered, and for a slight moment, I swear I saw a twinkle in Dottie's eye.
Well, get up. My stomach is growling,
she retorted like she didn't want him to go.
Another success, Maybelline.
Bobby Ray always said my name in his deep southern drawl that made every syllable much longer than it should be. I think it really is, but then again, we have a lot of hungry fishermen, I said, looking around at all the guests who'd had reservations for a long time in anticipation of the bass tournament. Not just the dinner part, but look over there. Abby pointed to a couple of campers who were comparing their poles and probably offering some tips for catching the big prize. I took a moment to reflect on how much success this particular event was having, each stop around the campfire offering a glimpse into the lives and the kitchens of our fellow campers, which they were sharing with each other. The campground community was really like no other. After Dottie excused herself with Henry in tow, I knew it was time to really support them and ensure we'd be at the right spot to cheer her and Henry on. Okay, so I'm not sure if Dottie told y'all how she's replaced me with Henry, I said, but everyone around the fire nodded. Well, she's got a better shot of winning the $5,000 prize.
Or even taking home the other prize money,
Bobby Ray said.
Henry Bryant is a heck of a fisherman. I've seen some of the things he's brought in.
I feel like even though she grumbles a lot, she does support us. And I, for one, would like to show my support tomorrow morning. I knew it was early to rise, but I also knew we could all get there before we had to work, since Henry would be putting his boat in at the dock there at Mill Creek Lake. Everyone huddled closer around the dwindling fire. The night had deepened, the stars above a testament to the secluded beauty of our little campground in the Daniel Boone National Forest.
I've got a stash of poster boards and all the crafting supplies you could imagine from the children's section at the library, Abby announced, her voice tinged with excitement. Glitter, paints, markers, you name it. We can make some fantastic signs to cheer them on.
We all know Dottie loves a good glitter and bedazzle, I choked out in a laugh. The idea was met with enthusiastic approval from everyone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.